Hi, I'm Iain, and today we're going to take a look at how to read radio schematics. So we're going to take a schematic for this radio. This is an RCA 1AX radio from 1940. This is the case. This is the guts to it. We're going to take the schematic, and we're going to look at how to read this and what it means on here. So we're actually going to compare the symbol to the physical thing in the radio. Back in the day, before the internet, the way you would get a radio schematic would be to get one of these books. And lots of different manufacturers used to print these. They would print one every year with the latest and greatest schematics from all the different manufacturers. And you would get the book that had the manufacturer you were looking for in it. And you would flip through until you found the model radio or phonograph you were looking for, and it would have the schematic. It would even have details sometimes on how to align the thing for optimum performance. Most libraries had some of these books back in the 40s and 50s. Well, nowadays you can still buy those books used, or you can go online and simply Google the model radio you have, and more than likely you will be able to find a PDF from one of those old books that has your schematic in it. So that's what I have here. The schematic has just enough information on it to be dangerous. And this is a key thing to remember. The engineer that made that schematic was trying to get by with putting as little information on there as possible. So you have to infer things from it, because they don't spell out every single thing. And there's a reason for that. The first reason is usually the person who designed the thing also drew the schematic for it. So they were more familiar with that thing than anybody else. So what's obvious to them is not as obvious to you or me coming here 50, 60 years after the fact looking at this and trying to think, what were they thinking of at the time? The other thing is, these schematics were drawn by hand. They didn't have any kind of CAD program on the computer to click and drag two symbols and transistors and whatever around. They had to draw it with little stencils, and they had to get it right for it to go to print. So they were trying to get away with as little drawing on it as possible. So we're going to see some instances where they could have been a little more clear, but it's better than nothing. Now, that's not to say you need a schematic to work on radios. Plenty of radios have been repaired with absolutely no schematic, because most of these things follow the same basic layout. So if you get used to one 5-tube radio, it's not a big jump to repair any of the 5-tube radios, just like the 6-tube radios. So let's dive into the schematic and see just how do you make heads or tails of this thing. So before we start looking at individual parts, it's important to understand the schematic as a whole. The general convention is that the schematic works left to right. So the circuit works left to right. What I mean by that is your inputs start at the left, and whatever happens because of those inputs takes place at the right. So in this case, it's a radio. So the radio waves start at the left. Audio comes out at the right. Input, output. Then the power supply is just thrown in wherever it can go. Usually down at the bottom. Sometimes you'll see power supplies for things at the top. But the power supply is kind of an afterthought. You just put it wherever. The big thing is whatever the circuit's supposed to do. In this case, receive radio waves. And if we look, we have the antenna on the left. We have the speaker on the right. So this follows that convention. So now we know the signals are, for the most part, going to flow this way. If there are feedback loops, obviously the feedback has to go back. But for the most part, everything is going to try to migrate from the left to the right. Now, just with the power supply being thrown in wherever, usually down at the bottom,
They will have notes of some kind, if there are any, or changes. If something was different about this model than the year before, they usually put it down at the bottom. In this case, there are some notes, there's an alignment procedure, there's the little tube diagram, and there's this thing that talks about the 1AX radio, which is this one, is a little bit different than the 1X and the 1X2, which is up here. This is the part that's different. Again, they didn't want to redraw this entire schematic if they didn't have to, so they just redrew the part that's different, and we just have to accept the fact that you take this, stick it on here, and the rest of it's going to be the same. So again, they try to do as little writing on these things as possible. The very first thing we need to cover before we do anything else in this schematic is to figure out what do these dots mean. If you look, there's a dot right here. Right here, there is no dot. The lines mean there's a connection. So there's a connection from here to here to here. Anywhere there's a dot with intersecting lines, that means there's a connection. So you can assume there is a blob of solder there hooking this wire, the horizontal line, to this vertical line. There is no blob right here. This wire and this wire are not connected at all. They just crisscross. No electrical connection. Right here, you can see this capacitor does connect to this horizontal wire and this vertical wire because there's a blob of solder right there. Here, there's no connection because there's no blob of solder right here. So anywhere there's a dot, the lines connect. Anywhere there is no dot, they have no idea the other one exists. So keep that in mind for the entire schematic. So if we start over here, because this is the input side of our schematic, and again, that note said that this applies to my radio, not the stuff up here. So if we look at this, here we have the leftmost part. So that is probably the input. And on a radio, the input's usually the antenna. If we take a look at this symbol, the triangle with the line coming down is usually the symbol for an aerial antenna, not a loop antenna. Here we have a loop antenna. That even says loop right on it, so that's kind of handy. Well, why do we have this thing and a loop? Well, this radio has a connector in the back, which happens to be this point one we're looking at, that can have a long wire antenna attached to it. So this is your long wire antenna, this is your loop antenna, this is the loop that couples the long wire antenna to the loop antenna. The loop antenna is the antenna on the back of the radio. If we scoot this down slightly, we see the antenna drawn for the back of the radio. And if you look, you have this point number one, corresponds to that point number one, to antenna lead. This is for your long wire antenna. If we follow this line, you'll see there's about two turns of wire on the inside that goes to point number two. C15 is written right here, and then we have point three. Well, if we look down here, we have point number two at the end of that little coil, and you can see that little coil is drawn physically smaller than the big coil. C15 goes to point three, which goes to ground. So here's the schematic drawing, here's the physical drawing. Now let's take a look at the radio and see those parts in real life. Here we have the cardboard back for the radio, and if you look right here, there's one connection and it says ANT for antenna on it. That is our point number one. Now, they don't label it point number one on the radio, but that's what it is on the schematic. You can see this wire in here in a loop. That's the loop. Now, there should be two loops in here, so let's turn it around and see if we have both loops. So if we look over here at the back of that antenna connection, we have the wire come up, and then presumably there's a couple turns of wire on the inside that make up the external antenna coupling loop. Then over here, just like in the picture, we have this capacitor. I'd be willing to bet that is capacitor 15. And if we look, we've got this wire that comes out of the inner loop and goes to this connector right here on this little terminal strip that connects to the capacitor, just like it showed in the diagram. So far, so good. Then we have this connection at the bottom of that capacitor that goes to this wire. So I assume this wire goes to ground. This wire, we don't know where it goes yet, but we will find out. So yes, so far the schematic has not led us astray. We have our external antenna connector. We have at least one coil of wire in here next to a second coil, because we have four pieces of wire coming out of this thing, so there has to be two coils in it somewhere. We have this capacitor, matches up with that capacitor. Everything's looking good so far. So let's see what happens with this bigger loop. If we take a look at the big loop antenna, and this can be used as a loop antenna without any external antenna attached to it. You get better reception with the long wire antenna, but that's an optional thing. For normal use in a populated area where the radio stations are pretty close, you can get away with just a loop antenna. And most all American 5 radios just have a loop antenna in the back. So here is the loop. We have connection point 4 and 5, and we have this 1 ohm in the middle of it. What is that? Well, that is the DC resistance of that loop. So if you put an ohm meter on it, it should read really close to 1 ohm. The reason for that is back in the day, most people didn't have inductance meters. They had full ohm meters or a vacuum tube voltmeter that could measure resistance. So lots of things were given in just regular DC resistance. So it was easy for a technician to test these things. So normal resistance in the 1 ohm range. If it's higher than that, you might have a bad solder connection somewhere. If it's open, you probably have a nicked wire in this coil somewhere. If it's less than 1 significantly, you probably have turns that are shorted. So that's what that 1 ohm is for. Now if we come up here, you'll see C1 and C2 are connected to it. And if we look, this wire, even though the reproduction didn't turn out real well, that really is connected all the way down to point number 5. So C1 and C2 are in parallel with the loop antenna. These are your tuning capacitors, and you'll see there's two of them, and C1 has this big arrow through it. C2 is slightly different. It's got a curved lower plate with a tiny little arrowhead on it. Okay, what does the big arrow going through it mean? That means it's a variable capacitor, so you can change the capacitance by moving it somehow. Well, this is the tuning capacitor. You move it by moving the tuning knob for changing radio stations. This little thing with the little arrow on the plate, that is a trimmer capacitor. That is for fine-tuning the adjustment of this thing, because these old capacitors, they were pretty reliable from the factory, but as you're going to see, they're a mechanical part. The plates can vary slightly with them, so to be able to do final tuning of the radio to get it where you think it's going to tune, they gave the serviceman this little trimmer capacitor. So let's take a look at what these capacitors look like. And here we have the air variable capacitor in this thing. And this really lets you see how a capacitor is made. It's a whole series of parallel plates that are parallel to another set of plates. As the surface area between the plates increases, as I close this together by turning the tuning knob, the capacitance value goes up. As I open it up, the capacitance value goes down. So I can change the capacitance by changing how much of these plates are meshed together. Now these plates are not supposed to touch the other plates. If they do, it shorts out the capacitor and the radio is not going to function the way you think it's going to. These are the things that need slight adjustment, because again, this is a big mechanical assembly. As much as they would like to believe they can get these plates spaced exactly where they think they are and exactly next to these every single time, it's a mechanical part, it's mass produced, variations exist. That means the capacitance of this thing fully meshed or fully open is going to vary from one radio to the other ever so slightly. So you need a way to fine tune those differences and make it so you can get reliable tuning again and again. That's what that C2, that little trimmer capacitor, was for. Well, where is the trimmer capacitor on this thing? Well, that's this screw right here. That's not a mounting screw. That's the trimmer capacitor. You don't want to mess with this thing unless you really want to have some fun realigning this radio. It's best to just leave those things alone if the thing's functioning. But that's where that C2 is. So this is C1, this is C2. I know this is C1 because it has this wire coming from that loop antenna right to it, just like the schematic said it would. Also, on a radio, the bigger half of the tuning of the variable capacitor is going to be your tuning capacitor. You'll see the section up front with smaller plates and fewer of them. That's for the local oscillator. And just like this one, to be able to compensate for slight differences from one to the next, it has a trimmer capacitor as well. And those symbols will be the exact same as this on the schematic. They're just going to be in a different place. They're going to be in control of the oscillator. So that's the variable capacitor and trimmer capacitor. So if you take a look down here, you're going to see that the other end of this coil and the variable capacitors goes to this line that says negative 13 volts approximate max AVC voltage. The AVC is automatic volume control. This is a little bit of negative feedback that is actually coming from farther down in the circuit back this way. And what it does is it tries to regulate the volume out on the radio. So that way, as the atmospheric conditions change throughout the radio broadcast and the radio signal gets slightly stronger, slightly weaker, it's not a noticeable change in volume. Otherwise, it'd be really obnoxious to listen to because you'd hear it get louder, softer throughout the thing. And the AVC is there to try and keep it consistent. So that's what that's for. That's also why you'll notice the air variable capacitors are not directly connected to the chassis. They have rubber grommets where they meet the chassis to keep the capacitors isolated from ground. Because again, these little lines are ground. This is not ground, so that's something to be aware of, that the little rubber grommets are there for insulation. If they're crumbling and falling apart and the thing starts touching the chassis, it's not going to work quite right because you're essentially shorting out your automatic volume control. If you take a look at this, this, and this, you're going to look and say to yourself that it looks like a coil. And it is. Now, these are three coils right near each other. And if we look, this says OSC coil. That's for oscillator coil. These are three coils on the same form. Again, they're trying to do as little drawing as possible so they don't draw anything to tell you they're connected. You just have to be aware of that's how these things are constructed. So these three coils are on the same little cardboard tube. And under the chassis, we're going to see a little cardboard tube with some wire on it. That's what this is. Again, we have a 1 ohm resistance from 0.6 to 0.7. We have a 7 ohm resistance from connection point 9 to connection point 10. Again, given in DC resistance because inductance meters just wasn't available to the average repair shop back in the 40s and 50s. So if you're going to check these coils out, you're going to check them out with an ohm meter. You'll notice this coil right here, 0.8 is attached to something, but the other end is just floating. So this, it's really not inductively coupled to these two. It's capacitively coupled. So they're actually using the capacitance in these turns of wire to pick the signal off this. Now, what is the oscillator coil trying to do? Well, the way these super heterodyne receivers works, you have a local oscillator that's generating a sine wave, and you have the sine wave from the radio waves coming in. You mix them together with what they call a converter tube, and you get out the difference of those two. So it steps the frequency down to your intermediate frequency. And that's kind of a generalized overview of the thing, but that's essentially what it does. It takes two frequencies, subtracts them, and you get the difference out to the IF intermediate frequency. So it's lower than your radio frequency, but still above the audio spectrum. So this is your oscillator. You have a tuned circuit, just like with the loop antenna. You had the loop, the inductance in the loop, and you had C1 and C2 forming a resonant circuit to tune your radio station. You have the oscillator coil windings, C3 and C4 forming a resonant circuit that create your oscillator frequency. And tuning C3 and C4, you can tune your oscillator frequency. Once again, that's a variable capacitor. That's that smaller air variable we looked at earlier. And C4 is that trimmer capacitor. That's the screw right next to the little air variable capacitor. If we follow up here, you will see this. So this is the 12SA7 tube. And that tube, if we look on this little layout diagram, is right here on the chassis. So we know where it's supposed to go in case we pull all the tubes out and we forget. So here we have 8 pins on this thing. And if we count the pins, you'll see there are 8. And it says what the pins are in terms of what they do. You can see this one says H. This one says H. Those are the heater connections. You have the grid connection. That's a G. You have the cathode connection. That's a K. Even though cathode is spelled with a C, they're always marked as K. And so forth. They aren't numbered. And they aren't in any particular order. So you can't assume that you start with pin 1 here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It might be that that's how the pins go, but usually not. Again, they are trying to take every shortcut they can. if they can eliminate crisscrossing lines and make the schematic more reasonable to have this be pin 1 and this be pin 5, they will make those pins whatever number they want on this little picture in order for it to have the cleanest layout. So we need to figure out which pin we're actually looking at. Now, if you know the tube, you know which pin these things connect to, great. If you're unfamiliar with the tube, the best thing to do is to look it up. Back in the day, if you were going to look up a tube, you would get one of these receiving tube manuals, and you would search through it until you found the tube you were looking for. In this case, the 12SA7 pentagrid converter tube. And sure enough, that's the tube we're looking at. What we would then do is look at the pin numbers and what they're attached to. And what I like to do is renumber the schematic, write the numbers of the pins next to the pins. So that way it's easy to troubleshoot. So that's what I'm going to do right now. I'm going to look at this picture, look at which connection goes where, what pin number it is, and I'm going to write that number next to these pins on here to make it a little bit easier. So after a couple minutes with the tube manual, I've numbered all the pins for this tube. So we have 5, 6, 2, 8, 1, 7, 3, 4. Again, they don't put them in any particular order, but for troubleshooting, I need to know what pin is what. And here we have it. So I have this symbol. This is the symbol for a resistor, R1. It tells me it is 22,000 ohms. Ohms isn't written because, again, they're trying to cut down on the writing and they just assume we know what unit a resistor is in. So we should be able to find a 22K ohm resistor connected between pin 5 and pin 6 of that tube. So let's go take a look under the chassis and see if in fact we have that resistor where we think it is. Here we have the 12SA7 tube and we have the oscillator coil. And again, it's a cardboard form with coils of wire on it. You'll notice it has these three tabs, and if we quickly revisit the schematic, we will see that it has the connection numbers next to those tabs, so we can figure out what we're looking at on the thing. And those numbers correspond with these numbers. If you look really, really carefully at the tube base, you will see there's a little locating notch in the base of the tube that fits a corresponding notch in the tube socket. That way the tube only goes in one way, unless you really hammer it in there, and at that point you've busted the tube. At that notch, starting from the left, going clockwise, you start counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's how the pins are numbered. Now if you look really, really close at the tube socket, they actually have the numbers cast in the Bakelite socket, so you can figure out what number pin you're looking at. So that's kind of handy. If we look really, really closely at it, we will see between pin 5 and pin 6, right down in there, we have a resistor that has two red stripes and an orange stripe. And by knowing the color code of resistors, that is a 22K ohm resistor. So sure enough, between pin 5 and 6, just like the schematic told us, we found that resistor. So if we look right here on pin 1 of that tube, we see this that looks like a garden rake. That is chassis ground. That's the metal chassis. If we look over here, we have regular ground. That kind of looks like an arrow made out of three horizontal lines. between ground ground and chassis ground, which is the metal chassis, we have a 0.2 microfarad, because if they don't tell us it's microfarad, and they're not going to put a UF after each one, because that's extra writing they don't need to do. Capacitor, C24. You also have a 220K resistor going from circuit ground to the chassis. So pin 5 connects directly to the chassis, and then what the circuit uses as ground connects to the chassis through a 22K resistor and that capacitor. So let's see if we can find those things. If we look at pin 1, there's a jumper that goes from that pin to the chassis. Then you have this 0.05 microfarad capacitor going from it to circuit ground. Now I know what you're thinking, wait a second, that's different than the schematic. Okay, here's the thing. This thing was made in 1940. I can already tell somebody's been in here rooting around, because these electrolytic capacitors are not the one it originally came with. Also, it has a polarized line cord on it, so I think somebody has done a little bit of creative rearranging of this, because they probably got zapped on this chassis and decided they weren't going to do that again. So don't be alarmed if what you find under one of these things isn't exactly what the schematic said, because this has had a long time to be played with, and like here, this is a much newer capacitor. It's still an old capacitor, but it's much newer than the radio. So sometimes things get altered. So now if we take a look, we have pin 4 and pin 3 of the tube going over to this coil, because we know it's some kind of coil, because it looks just like these coils, but smaller, with a variable capacitor, because we have that symbol, with this dotted box around it. What is that? Okay, that tells me that this is half of something else in a container. In this case, this is the first IF transformer, intermediate frequency, because again, we have the oscillator, we have the radio frequency coming in off the antenna, they're getting subtracted from each other, and it steps it down to 450 kilocycles, or nowadays speak, kilohertz. So we go from radio frequency to the intermediate frequency of 455 kilohertz, kilocycles, moving forward with this thing. This is the first of the two intermediate frequency transformers. This is one half of the transformer. Where's the other half? Well, remember, this is the part that's different with this radio versus the other one shown in this drawing. If we come up here, here is the first intermediate frequency transformer, right here. Notice this is this. So at this point, we take this part of the circuit and we take everything from this half of the transformer this way. We ignore this part and substitute in this part. So here matches up to here. So from here on out, we're looking up here. So if we look, see how they draw the entire box around this? And then they ground that box. This is the metal shield on the outside of the intermediate frequency transformers. A transformer is made up of two separate windings. So you have a coil and a coil, primary and a secondary, just like a power transformer. Only this one works at much higher frequencies. Just like before, where these are mass-produced things, there's certain variations that naturally occur in things that are man-made, you need to be able to account for that, to adjust those variances out, and you have these little trimmer capacitors in it. Now, these trimmer capacitors have a lot more movement in them than the ones that we looked at earlier, so they have the symbol with the little arrow going through. Again, they just kind of mix and match those things just to tell you it's something different. And that's also kind of a personal preference thing of whoever drew the schematic. But it's got coils in it, and it's got variable capacitors with some sort of shielding enclosure that's grounded. And if we look, oh, here it is. And we know this is it because I've seen an IF transformer can before, but there's also a couple things that'll tell us this if we've never seen it before. It has two screws in the top. Those are the trimmer caps on the primary side and the secondary side. Also, here is our 12 SA7 tube. It would make sense to have the primary of that transformer right next to the tube because the signal has to go through that transformer to the next stage. So it needs to physically be located between that tube and the next stage. Here it is. The other thing is, it's got this big metal can on it that is connected to the chassis to be able to ground the IF transformer. Hooray for it. Now, we can just keep moving our way down the circuit as we have been, because you're going to see the different symbols just keep repeating themselves. And if we work through it methodically, once you master some of the symbols, you'll see there's just slight variations on them. So let's see, how do we figure out the leads to this transformer?
So we've figured out what the transformer looks like from the top, but how do we wire it from the bottom? Because it's in a metal can, I can't really see what coil goes where. Well, you'll notice this is red, this is black, this is green, hard to read the green, but it's there, and this says blue. So if we look down here, because again, this is the front part of the schematic we're looking at, blue, red, it's exactly the same as up here, that didn't change. Those are the wire colors. So we're going to see four wires sticking out the bottom of that can that are blue, red, black, and green. And so we'll be able to follow those wires and see it go to the next tube. And we'll be able to follow this all the way down, because if we look, we've got another tube. It's a different type of tube. This is the 12SK7, so we need to look that up and then number those pins so that way we know what we're looking at under there. But once again, the output of that tube goes to the blue wire on this second IF transformer. And of course, you have a red wire coming out of it, just like before. You have another green one. In this case, you have a yellow wire coming out, and then if you see this thing kind of scoots along here, the shielding continues along. You also have a black wire and a brown wire coming out of that transformer. So a little bit more out of the second transformer, but again, that dotted line tells you that's all in that metal casing. So that also tells us that this C11 and C13 are also in that metal can somewhere. So not only do we have trimmer capacitors, we also have two fixed value capacitors hiding in that can. Again, we know they're in that can because of the dotted line around them. Here we have what looks like a resistor with an arrow pointing to it. That's a variable resistor. That's the potentiometer that makes up the volume control. Again, with the capacitor, we recognize that. And we just keep moving on down the line. Basically, all the symbols start repeating at this point. If we look down here, we will... If we look down here,
we see something that looks kind of familiar, but it's a little different. We have coils of wire right next to each other. That's probably either a coil or a transformer. Now, this is where it helps to have seen it once before. Whenever you see these three lines in the center of it, that means it's a laminated iron core. That implies transformer. And laminated iron cores don't do well at high frequencies. So that means we're looking at a low frequency thing. So it's either going to be a power transformer or an audio transformer. Well, given the fact that this is the output tube and its whole job in life is to output audio, and it's connected to this transformer, and we have this cone looking thing that says 4 ohms with a coil, you have a 4 ohm speaker, speaker coil, speaker cone, symbol for speaker, attached to this thing. It's a good bet this is an audio transformer. So, ta-da, we have the audio transformer that drives the speaker. That's the symbol for the audio transformer. If we come down here, we have a couple other interesting things. We have the 117 volt AC plug. Don't worry if you have 120 volts, it'll work just fine. We have the power switch. That switch looks like it's separate, but it's built into the volume control. That's what makes the snap when you first turn the volume on. That snap you hear is actually that switch closing. So not only does it work the volume, it also turns the set on and off. You have your rectifier tube. Again, you can look that up in the manual, whatever tube number they say it is. Look up that tube, write down the pin numbers so you know what's connected where. You have the dial lamp. It looks like a little coil of wire in a circle. That's because they're trying to draw a little coiled up filament in a little glass bulb. Then you have all these little house looking things with tube numbers next to them. These are the symbols for the heaters. That's what makes the tubes glow orange. Tubes only work if the cathodes are hot. Here we have the heaters to do that. If you add up the voltages of the heaters, you have 12, 12, 12, 50, and 35, you'll get something close to 117 volts. That's how they can run these things without any transformer in them. Over here, you're going to see a couple symbols. They look like capacitors with this big cup shape around them. And this is something that varies throughout time. Sometimes you see them with the cup going up. Nowadays, it's common to see it with a semicircle going down for the bottom plate. These have a plus next to them. Sometimes you'll see them with a negative on the other side. The curved plate, whether it curves up or down, is the negative. The straight plate is the positive. These are electrolytic capacitors. They're polarized. If you get them backwards, they unravel with a bang. So you want to be careful of that. That's the symbol for a polarized capacitor. Again, the symbol for a polarized capacitor has changed slightly throughout time, but you're going to see that they're a fairly big value, 30 microfarad and 50 microfarad. And those values will change slightly from radio to radio, but they're going to be in that range somewhere. Now this is MFD, microfarad. That's something that has also changed. Nowadays, microfarad is usually written as this, not an M. That's something that has changed throughout time, and it's just something to be aware of. If you see a UF or this little mu F, that's microfarad. If you see MFD on an old schematic, that's also microfarad. That's not millifarad or megafarad. Now you'll notice this says green, red, and black. What does that mean? Things have changed a bit since these radios were first built. One of those things is a lot of electronic components are way cheaper nowadays than they used to be. Nowadays, we are accustomed to seeing individual capacitors. So here, somebody has replaced the electrolytics in here with newer ones, but they're individual capacitors. That's not what this radio would have originally had. It would have had a capacitor like this. Here's an old one out of a different radio that says the red is a 60 microfarad capacitor. Again, note the MFD symbol. And the green is a 20 microfarad capacitor. The black is the common negative, it says. So this would go to the chassis, and you have your two capacitors in one cardboard tube. That's how they used to do it. Now, we have individual capacitors for things. So that's why those two look like they're hooked together with colors for the leads. That's what they used to have. And if you look real carefully, you'll actually see the red wire goes to the 47 microfarad and the green wire, or what used to be green at one point, goes to the 33 microfarad capacitor. And then the black wire goes to the negative of both of them. So somebody left the wires in place and just replaced the capacitor with modern ones.
So hopefully this has helped clear up how to read radio schematics. And like anything, it just takes practice. The best thing to do is to get the schematic, get the radio, pull the chassis out of the radio, and actually compare the schematic to the radio. Now remember, after 50 plus years, there could be alterations in that radio. So if things don't line up exactly, that could be the reason. The big thing to remember is schematics work from the left to the right. The power supply is usually thrown in wherever it can fit as an afterthought. They usually have notes down at the bottom. And anywhere that two lines intersect and connect, there'll be a dot. If there's no dot there, they don't actually make a connection. They're just overlapping on the page because it's a two-dimensional document. So I hope this helps with your radio restorations.